Hello everyone, we welcome you all for the second day of Ritual Open Week 2020 of CCMB. Every year at CCMB, we all wait for this day, open day, to meet and educate young minds of our country. This year, we decided, let's get it to the next level, from few thousands to the whole country. After the exciting and educating sessions of yesterday, here we have another Mindstorm session. This year, we are here with another mindstorming session, Life in 3D. Be ready with your bags packed and let's experience Life in 3D. Before starting the session, I request all the participants who have joined via MS Teams to mute yourself and switch off your videos. Let's begin this journey.
Before going ahead, what structural biology matters to us? So macromolecules, structural biology. So macromolecules are the molecules which are huge molecules. So before going ahead, let's understand what are macromolecules. Macromolecules are large molecules composed of several atoms which are covalently linked to each other. So let's have an examples of macromolecules: lipids, carbohydrates, proteins, and nucleic acids are the classic examples of macromolecules. The food we eat on day-to-day basis, which are starch, whoever eats rice, is nothing but a macromolecule and it's a carbohydrate. These macromolecules are polymers of many monomers. However, we are mainly interested and focused on proteins. So today's topic will be mostly revolving around proteins. So protein, what are proteins? Protein is a polymer of several amino acids linked together by a covalent bond. There are only 20 different types of amino acids typically, and these are linked in different sequence manners in different combinations to give proteins, and they can be from as small as 10 amino acid peptide to many thousands of amino acids linked to each other to give a huge proteins. Who dictates the sequence of a protein is a general question which we ask. The answer is simple: genetic information, that is nothing but the DNA, decides what a protein should be coding for. The DNA is transcribed into RNA and the RNA is translated into proteins. Who does this function of translating the RNA to proteins? It's nothing but ribosomes are the one which are involved in translation, which will be explained in detail in the upcoming session. However, proteins are workhorses of the cell, and therefore understanding its function and structure is crucial. Let me give you one example which tells how important are proteins. I am sure that all of you all are very well aware of hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is nothing but a protein which is part of RBCs, the red blood cells, which carry oxygen. So what happens if the hemoglobin is not there in the cells? And there are many defects noted, which are called as thalassemias, where the hemoglobin is having a problem in carrying the oxygen and people suffer from diseases. So one of the classic example which is very well studied and explored and explained to the public is sickle cell anemia, where a small mutation in a hemoglobin leads to distortion in its structure and ultimately defers its function and reduces its oxygen carrying capacity, and thereby people who have such a defective hemoglobin, called in the case of sickle cell anemia, leads to reduced oxygen carrying capacity, and therefore they face difficulties whenever they move in high altitude places where the oxygen carrying capacity is less. So with this example, it might be very clear why a structure of a protein is so important, because it's ultimately going to decide its function. And that tells the importance of structure function relationship. So how do we know how a protein looks like? So we generally take a photograph of a person and decide how a person looks like. We can weigh and we can measure the height and all. Similarly, how do we look at proteins? Is there a way to look at them? Because they're ultra tiny, which we cannot see with our naked eye. We need to have some sophisticated techniques to look at them. So you must heard about it, but not very much into it. Well, there are mainly three techniques called nuclear magnetic resonance, the NMR, X-ray crystallography, which use X-rays for understanding the structure of the protein, and the third, which is widely being used right now and which is being explored more and more and which is revolutionizing structural biology, is cryo-EM, that's electron microscopy at cryo conditions. And you will be given the examples and how they work for all these three in the coming session. Therefore, today's session, the life in 3D, the banner of our session, which is going to mainly be focused on structural biology, is presented to you by Dr. Shankar Narayanan's lab and his group teammates. The team here is going to take you through important concepts of structural biology. In the process, we will be having a demo session where they'll show you how to purify a protein, how to crystallize a protein, and also all the way to solving its structure and how structure matters. How important is it to know the structure and how it's going to look inside a cell with so many proteins? And thirdly, we are going to also explain to you all the structural biology in the context of the current pandemic, that is COVID, which we call it as COVID biology, and how important it is knowing its structure and functions of these proteins which are involved in COVID. So today's session, we are going to have life in 3D, which is going to explain about the structural biology, which we do it in general, the concepts involved in it. And this session is being brought to you by Dr. Shankar Narayan Lab and its lab members. The team here is going to take you through important concepts of structural biology. In the process, we will have a demo session where the team is going to show you all how to purify a protein, how to express it, purify it, and also crystallize, followed by structure determination. And after that, we will have a session on how structures really matters to us, and inside a cell, how structures look like. And thirdly, in the current situation of pandemic, how COVID biology is being explored using structural biology. And at the end, we are going to also discuss about what we do at CCMB, how we are using structural biology to understand the basic principles of how cells function. So this is how we are going to go throughout the session. And once these are done, we'll have a quiz session followed by an interactive session, which is a question and answer session.
Proteins. What are proteins? Let's find out. We all know that machines make our life easier in our day-to-day life. We come across a lot of machines. Some cut, some join, some build, some crush, and some transport too. You think you have seen all of them? Maybe not. Have you heard about machines that help us to survive? They are called proteins. So, do you know what these proteins do inside you? For that, we have to know what proteins are made up of. Like any other machine, proteins are also made up of different pieces. These pieces are called amino acids. There are 20 different amino acids. Each amino acid has a name and a one-letter code. Let's look at the amino acid methionine. Its one-letter code is M. All amino acids are made up of carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, hydrogen, and some also have sulfur. But have you ever wondered why they are called amino acids? The answer is simple. They have an amino group and an acid or a carboxylic group. Each amino acid have a unique side chain. These amino acids join together in different combinations to form chains, the primary structure. Amino acids are linked together by peptide bonds. So, proteins are also called as polypeptides. Primary structure is a string of amino acids which self-organize into secondary structures. One among them is alpha helices, which looks like a spring. The another secondary structure is beta sheets. These alpha helices and beta sheets interact to form tertiary structure. For example, here we are looking at a subunit of a protein which can bind to iron. For this protein, the quaternary structure is a complex of four subunits. Quaternary structure are complex made up of similar or different subunits. Why does this protein have iron? In this protein, iron helps to bind to oxygen and carries it to various parts of the body through blood. It is called hemoglobin and it is present in red blood cells. Hemoglobin is the protein which gives red color to the blood. We now know what proteins are made up of. Now let's look at their function. Proteins can do various jobs like helping in defense, functions as a storage unit, help in transport. There are different proteins that acts as a defense mechanism in the body. Here we are seeing an antibody, which is one among them. Like a missile, which can be targeted, this antibody here targets and binds to the viral particles. As a pillar is to the building, collagen gives structural support to your skin. Similar to the motor pump that pumps water, cells have various proteins that transport different components in and out of the cell. Like we communicate with each other by various devices, proteins help in communication between cells. A classic example is insulin, which informs the cell about blood sugar level. Enzymes are biological catalysts which increase the rate of a reaction. Here we are seeing an enzyme called alpha amylase that helps in digestion. Till now, we have learned what proteins do. Proteins with different structure do different functions. To know what a protein does, we need to be able to see the shape and structure of the protein. What do you think about the size of the protein? How big is it? To understand the size of the protein, let's start with things which we can see with naked eyes. If we look at this average size of a human being, it is approximately 175 centimeters. But a mouse, which is a model organism, has a size up to 8 centimeters. Human's fingernail, which is of a smaller size compared to a mouse, is about 1.5 centimeters. Now, let us see the size of household things which we see around in day-to-day life. If we look at a coffee bean, it is of a length 12 millimeter. Millimeter is nothing but 10 times smaller than centimeter. Similarly, a grain of rice, a sesame seed, and even a grain of salt are of few millimeter in size. Let's move to the microorganisms one cannot see through naked eyes. These organisms are in size of micrometers, which is nothing but 1,000 times smaller than millimeter. These organisms can only be visualized through microscopes. Towards your right, you can see the microscopic image of these microorganisms. These microorganisms' sizes are comparable to the sizes of cells which are present in the human body. Let's see some cells that are a few microns. If you see human egg, which is the female reproductive cell, is also a few micrometer in size. Photoreceptor, the cells which is present in our eyes, help us to visualize the colors. Sperms are male reproductive cells. Human skin cell that is present in the outer covering of the body. Red blood cells is important because they contain hemoglobin that carries oxygen to all parts of the body. If we further zoom inside a cell, we see different organelles of size ranging from micrometer to nanometer. Nanometer is 1,000 times smaller than micrometer. Lysozyme is a membrane-bound organelle which is found in all animal cells that contains hydrolytic enzymes that can break down many biomolecules. The powerhouse of the cell, mitochondria, is a double membrane-bound organelle. It is found in most of the eukaryotic cell. E. coli is a rod-shaped bacteria that is commonly found in lower intestine of the humans. Viruses is also submicroscopic agent whose size is smaller than bacteria. Viruses infect all types of living forms that include animals, plants, and even microorganisms like bacteria. Now we can look at the cellular components. Ribosome, the protein production factory of the cell, is about 30 nanometer, whereas antibody is about 12 nanometer. Transfer RNA or tRNA, the adapter molecule that supplies amino acid to the ribosome, is about 7 nanometer. Since protein size ranges from angstrom to nanometer, such smaller proteins cannot be seen through microscope. To visualize the protein structure, there are various specialized techniques adapted widely, which will be discussed in the coming session. X-rays were discovered by William Rontgen, and he was awarded Nobel Prize in Physics in 1901. This was the first Nobel Prize in the field of physics. Apart from medical applications, X-ray opened up a new avenues in the area of structural biology. Max Perutz and John Kendrew were the pioneers who saw the first structure of protein, the myoglobin and the hemoglobin. In 1962, they were awarded Nobel Prize. And it was in the same year James Watson, Francis Crick, and Morris Wilkins got Nobel Prize for proposing the structure of DNA. The next breakthrough was in understanding the structure of photosynthetic reaction center and showing that the membrane proteins can also be crystallized. For this research in 1988, John Robert Huber, Hartmann Michael was awarded Nobel Prize. X-ray crystallography not only allowed to solve the structure of protein, but also the entire protein synthesis machinery, the ribosome. In the year 2009, Thomas Tites, Venki Ramakrishnan, Ada Yona, was awarded Nobel Prize for solving the structure of ribosome. And it helped to elucidate the mechanism of action of several ribosome-targeting antibiotics.
Now that we have learned about how the biomolecules that make up the cells look like and how scientists visualize them, let us have a quick virtual tour of the structural biology facility at CCMB, where scientists are trying to solve structure of many important biomolecules to understand various unknown things about cells. At Structural Biology Lab in CCMB, we are using state-of-the-art technologies available in the world in our day-to-day experiments. You know, we have many robots, which are for special purpose of helping us making protein crystals for our experiments. Isn't it exciting? We would have loved to let you all come over here to CCMB in the open day and see the cool robots and the protein crystals by yourselves. But the coronavirus pandemic has made it impossible this time. But that cannot stop us from passing on the excitement virtually. Now let's have a glimpse of a day in life of a scientist working in the structural biology lab at CCMB.
Hey Sachi, actually I heard that you are purifying a protein today.
Yeah.
What protein it is?
So this is a protein called green fluorescent protein, that is GFP in short. We call it so because it glows and emits green color.
Wow, it's so fascinating.
Yeah,
it is. Actually, I have never purified a protein before. Can I join with you today?
Yeah, sure, why not?
So, where do we find this protein?
So, naturally, this protein is found in jellyfish, which is a marine organism. and it so the jellyfish grows in that.
Is it like we have to grow jellyfish here?
No, we need not to grow. Let's say even if we can grow jellyfish in lab, what if you want to work on a protein that is expressed in tiger and lion? Will you be able to get tiger and lion around?
Yeah, I can get it now.
No, right? So, and not only is it practically impossible, but also unethical as well.
So, in that case, actually, how will you get the protein here?
Yeah. So, now...
Okay. So, how will you get the protein then?
Fortunately, the advancement in technology has helped us to a point where we need not culture or grow all the organisms that we want to study, but we can get the sequence of the protein of our interest from that organism's genome, put it in a surrogate system like bacteria, viruses, etc., and exploit them to express our protein of interest. So for today, we are using bacteria called E. coli, which we have modified to produce large quantity of green fluorescent protein. Come, we'll show you the plate with the bacterial colonies. So these are the bacterial colonies, that is, one single colony has approximately millions of bacteria together. So now we will grow these bacteria in large scale culture to get enough number of cells so that we have sufficient amount of green fluorescent protein to purify.
Okay, so these cells are expressing our proteins now. How will you get the proteins out of the cells?
We will break open the cells using some routine techniques which either break the cells physically by exerting pressure on the cells or chemically which dissolves the outer layer of the cells. For example, sonication is a technique which uses sound waves to disrupt the cell walls of bacteria. In the other method, we use specific enzymes to dissolve the cell wall.
But there will be a lot of proteins inside bacteria, right? So how will you get your protein of interest? For example, in our case, we are using E. coli. This bacteria has 4,000 proteins in it. How do we spot a given protein?
So there is a technique called chromatography, which helps us to separate proteins utilizing different properties of our proteins like size, charge, etc. We'll show you the protein purification equipment. This is the system that we use for purifying the proteins. Here we load the mixture of protein that we get after breaking down the cells. By exploiting the property which is very specific to a given protein, we can separate out our protein. You can see a graph on the screen which indicates which fraction has our protein. So you remember we are purifying green fluorescent protein, and here we can see the green color in the tubes. But remember, not all proteins are having color. Proteins are generally colorless.
So what all can we do with the protein in order to solve the structure of it?
There are different techniques that we can use to solve the protein structure, like NMR, that is nuclear magnetic resonance, X-ray crystallography, cryo-electron microscopy. Coming to X-ray crystallography technique, as the name itself suggests, we need to have crystals of our protein.
What do you mean by crystals here?
So by definition, a crystal is a solid material whose constituent molecules are periodically arranged in all the three spatial dimensions. Oh, did I make it complicated? Okay, let's keep it simple.
Okay, how do we crystallize a protein?
So all of you might know that we get salt crystals by drying seawater out in the sun. So the principle behind this process is, as water evaporates, the concentration of salt increases. Because of the high concentration, salt molecules start to crystallize. Similarly, in our lab, we dry out the protein solution in a very slow and controlled environment. The pure protein solution are placed as small drops in closed chamber, and water is allowed to evaporate slowly, helping the protein to crystallize. You must have seen sugar or salt crystals. Like in case of salt, there are two atoms, sodium and chloride, which are periodically arranged in a particular ordered manner. This type of three-dimensional arrangement gives rise to crystals. Now we have set up crystallization plate with GFP and have kept the plate for crystals to grow. Based on the properties and concentration of the protein, it takes its own time to crystallize. Like some crystals can grow in hours and some might take months.
Why do we need crystals?
Oh, since proteins are very, very small, like approximately 1,000 times smaller than the size of a bacteria. So in order to get the structure of it, we need millions of protein molecules arranged in an orderly repeated fashion. So protein crystals actually help to enhance the signal of protein. Okay, we'll check now if our crystals have grown. Now we have the crystals ready, which we'll be mounting onto the stage.
Now our crystals are ready, but how will we get the structure using these protein crystals?
For this, we expose our crystals to X-rays. But the important question here is, why only X-rays? Why not any other electromagnetic wave? This is so because the distance between the atoms of a protein molecule is equivalent to the wavelength of X-rays. This allows X-rays to penetrate the protein molecules and show the arrangement of atoms inside the molecules. From here, the X-rays come, which will hit the crystal and get diffracted. After this, this is the detector which will detect the diffracted X-rays. If you want to know how diffraction occurs, you can read about Young's double slit experiment. So this is how a diffraction pattern looks like. All the spots present here contain information for the structure of the protein, which is derived from the electron density of different atoms in a protein. Finally, with the help of some computational analysis, we'll get the electron density for the protein, where we will fit the amino acid sequence that we already know, thus solving the structure of the protein.
Now we got some basic idea about crystals and how we solve structure of protein through X-ray crystallography. But imagine a scenario where the protein can't be crystallized. Do you think those structures can't be solved? No. We can actually use a technique called as NMR, that is nuclear magnetic resonance, to solve those structures. In this technique, we can use magnetic property of the electrons which is present in the protein to solve the structure. Another important advantage of this technique is we can actually know the dynamics of the protein. Another important and advanced technique called cryo-electron microscopy is revolutionizing the field of structural biology now. For this technique, after getting the pure protein, they will be spread as a very thin layer in a tiny grid. These grids then will be freezed and bombarded with electrons at the speed of light. Protein's different orientation will be obtained through this process, and then with the help of computer algorithms, three-dimensional structure can be obtained. Electron microscopy actually gives magnification approximately 10,000 times more than the normal microscopes.
Now, after model building and refinement, we get to know the structure of GFP. So finally, this is how GFP looks.
Wow, it looks so cool. But what is the importance of this protein?
So GFP has actually revolutionized the field of life sciences. Nobel Prize 2008 was awarded for its discovery. It was first used in a model organism called C. elegans, which is basically a worm, to check the gene expressions. Individual proteins in human cells, or in any other cell for that matter, are too small to see even under a microscope. But catching a glimpse of them in action is just invaluable. And this was only possible with the use of green fluorescent protein. For example, attaching green fluorescent protein to any protein inside a cell helps us to track whether a protein is getting expressed inside a cell or not, and also where the tagged protein actually localizes.
Now, we have seen how different molecules look like and how actually we can see them. You can see how diverse these proteins are. You might be wondering inside the cell how these proteins are arranged. So to find out how these proteins are arranged inside the same cell, we utilize another technique known as cryo-electron tomography. Here we can use entire cells, and I'm going to show you how we can see with the help of bacteria. So we take bacteria, and in this we take images of bacteria from different angles, and after that we stitch them together, and with the help of computers, what we do, we make a 3D map of it. So we can see it in a 3D. And as this image is high resolution image, so we can actually zoom into the small part like in the cell wall, where you can actually see how the different molecules are arranged in the cell wall. And we can actually find out other different molecules, how they are actually arranged inside the cell. Like here we can see outer cell wall, inner membrane, peptidoglycan, DNA, ribosome, in the flagellar motor, everything, whatever you like. And we can actually give them different colors and make a 3D map out of it, which can be used to visualize different things. Now, we have seen how these molecules can be visualized inside a cell. So, we must be very excited and want to see how inner life of the cell look like. So, if you're ready to go a tour inside the cell, so bring your mask and we can go inside the cell. Our body is made up of billions of the cells, and these cells have different shape and sizes. So in this video, we can see the red color cells are the red blood cells which carry oxygen to each of our cells, and the blue cells are the immune cells. And these cells, they interact with each other with the help of the proteins, which are known as tethering proteins. And this network is highly organized and provide strength to the cells which is attached to its own surface. Like our home has walls, so cell also has a wall which is made up of lipids, and this wall is not a solid molecule, not a liquid molecule, but it's kind of a semi-solid, where all different kinds of things, like there will be a lot of proteins which are there, which actually connects from outer environment to the inner environment. And this wall is required for maintaining the homeostasis inside the cell. Now, you might be wondering, if there is a wall, then how cell gets nutrient inside it? So there are different kinds of transport, like passive transport, where if there are higher concentration of the solutes from the one side, then it start moving into the lower concentration side. So there are other mode of transport also, like active transport, where we can actually transport molecule from the lower concentration to higher concentration with the help of energy, like you can see in this yellow molecule, which acts as an energy molecule. And this way, the cell can actually transfer material from outside to inside. Like our home has pillars which actually provide strength to our cell. Similarly, inside the cell, cell is having a lot of the pillars which are made up of proteins, and these proteins actually provide strength and maintain the shape and size of the cell. You can see how beautifully these pillars are arranged inside the cell. And this network is so organized, wherever it is required, it is built with the help of small protein molecules and make a big polymer-like chain. And these, wherever it is not required, then cell will bring another set of protein known as protease, which actually comes and cut this chain of network. And this is how cell maintains its own shape. By this, it can change its shape. Like at our home, we have transport systems where we can transfer things from one place to another with the help of like railways, where trains are running on the track. Similarly, inside the cell, we have tracks which are made up of proteins and other proteins known as dynein, which act as a kind of rail which brings a lot of cargo over them. And you can see how these proteins actually walk each other. And this is only possible with the help of structural biology. Our brain controls everything, whatever we do. Similarly, inside the cell, everything is controlled by the information that is stored inside our DNA. And the DNA is inside the nucleus. So whenever any message is need to be sent outside, that it comes in the form of RNA molecule. And this RNA is basically kind of a messenger RNA. And these messenger RNA, they comes out, and there are small machineries known as ribosome, which comes and actually decodes that information. And that information is made in the form of small protein molecules, like with the help of these ribosomes. And these protein molecules, they actually go and execute whatever message has come to them, and they will do their functions. So these information can be directly processed to the places where are required, like in the case where this information is required at the place of mitochondria. So these ribosomes, they go directly to the mitochondria and actually form a protein over it. So now you might be wondering, what are these mitochondria? So mitochondria are basically the powerhouse of the cells, like we have at our home, where we get energy from those places. And these mitochondria, basically they convert the energy molecule from the whatever food we consume. And if we cut this mitochondria into half, what you will find that it is made up of an outer membrane, and inside there is another membrane. This inner membrane is folded inside so that now we can have lot of surface area. And on the surface area, there are a lot of important reactions which are actually going on, as you can see over here, where there are a lot of proteins, they work in a harmony. And like here you can see one set of the protein known as complex one, the chemicals comes to them where they will do certain changes and lead to the production of some kind of molecules. These molecules go to the another complex, from that complex to another complex, which actually lead to the formation of an energy potential between the membrane. And due to this energy potential, now another set of the proteins, which actually moves like a motor, you can see over here. And this movement of the rotor actually lead to the production of the energy, like whatever we see in our case of hydroelectric power plants, where the water is used to move those turbines and the energy is produced inside the cell. Okay, so now if cell want to send a bunch of the protein from one place to another place, then how would it take place? So what will happen? Now cell will actually package those molecules in the small form of vesicles, like you can see over here. And these vesicles are again being transported with the help of those like walking molecules. Those molecules like carry those big cargos and bring it to membrane. Once it comes to membrane, it fuses it to that, and everything is exported outside. Now you can see there are so many proteins which are being exported out. it is not only the proteins, there can be DNA, anything which need to be exported out. And once they are exported out, these proteins, they start their own function. Like you can see over here, if they need to be like attached to another surface, they will start attaching to the surface, or if they want to do some kind of enzymatic reaction, they will start doing that. This can be a signal for an outside cell that this cell is near to it, or this can be a signal for a cell to migrate. So cell can migrate anywhere in the body from one place to another place with the help of these molecules. Mostly the cells which are of immune function, they actually migrate from one place to another place to find if there is any problem over there. So these cells, they actually act like a police which scans the whole area if there is any threat over there. If they find any threat over here, and they simply go and kill that cell. If any of the cell inside our body is having any kind of the problem, like it is shown over here in the green, so this we are seeing around 5000 times the magnification. As I told you that there are immune cells which actually do surveillance, and they will go around and find out if there is any problem somewhere else. So like over here, you can see that now some immune cell, it's moving from the surrounding area and it looks around. So here the red cells are healthy, and once it find out, oh, now we found there is a problem with this cell. Now we will zoom around 10 million times the magnification and see actually what is happening at the surface. So now the cells which are actually having any kind of the problem, they start showing some kind of the molecules known as death receptors. And the killer cell, basically an immune cell, it is having kind of a ligand which bounds to the. So once those two cells come in close proximity, so the death protein, it founds its receptor on the disease cells, and now once it founds, it starts doing a kind of a signal is being propagated inside the cell. It is not as simple as it looks like, but it is kind of very complex mechanism which is going on inside the cell. And there are a lot of the proteins which come together and start functioning towards the death of the cell. So these proteins, they will start activating one another. Now you can see over here, now this complex is formed, it has activated, it will go and binds to other molecules, and this is how the activation and inactivation goes on and lead to a very huge amount of signal inside the cell. So this is how cell actually will start knowing, now I have to die, and there is bunch of proteins are involved in this. This process will be continued until all the proteins required in that process gets activated, and this process continues till then. We can see how diversely and how enormous these signals, they start growing inside the cell, and these signals will reach to the powerhouse of the cells that we have seen earlier, known as the mitochondria. And these powerhouse, once they come in contact with this signal, they will start releasing a kind of molecule which is actually required in the formation of the final machine known as apoptosis. So these, you can see these beautiful structure, they will start coming in close contact and will be start forming the final domain which is required for the death of the cells. So once this entire complex is formed, it will start producing kind of a molecular seizures which will start going and degrading the other molecules. Like there will be the proteins which are involved in the degradation of the protein, other proteins or the DNA or the RNA which is present inside the cell. So we have seen the cell is having lot of the pillars which provide strength to them. So these activated proteins, they will come and start chewing up them. And ultimately, what will happen? All the pillars which are made of the protein inside the cell, they will start degrading itself. And ultimately, what will happen? The cell will start collapse. This is how a cell is removed from the system. And whatever molecules were there inside that cell, they actually come out in the surrounding. And the surrounding cells will take those molecules as a nutrient and they will be cleared out. This was all about animal cell. So you might be wondering, what about the plant cell? So if you want to know about the plant cell, so we'll go inside the plant cell now. The life is beautiful because of the plants around us. And these are the organisms which actually provide us the oxygen we need for our survival. So if we go and zoom into the plant cell, how these cells actually look like. So we are not now going inside the plant and see how these things are arranged over there. So whatever oxygen is like produced inside the cell, they are actually exchanged with the help of these small pores which are present in the leaf known as the stomata. And these stomata, they can open and close according to the requirement. If you go inside the plants, what you will find? You will find there are like billions of the cells which are arranged into this organism. And these organisms, they look green because of a chemical which is present in them known as chlorophyll. And this chlorophyll has a green color into it. So we can see in the case of plants, there is one more extra thing that is more greenish you can see over there alongside the mitochondria. That is the actual feature which distinguishes the plant cell from the animal cell. And this organelle is known as the chloroplast. And these are the places where the light energy is basically converted into the chemical energy. You can see here, there the membranes are actually stacked over each other. And this stacking is because to increase the surface area so that now the more and more light can be absorbed over here and more energy can be produced inside the cell. So like we have seen the molecular motors which were there in the case of mitochondria, similar kind of molecular motors are also there which produce energy in the case of chloroplast. There are different kind of the complexes, protein complexes, which are present in these membranes, which actually takes light as a source of energy, and from there they will convert lot of chemical potential is generated. And this chemical potential, as we have seen in the case of mitochondria, lead to the rotation of those molecular motors for the energy production. During this process, the photolysis of water is take place and which actually provides the oxygen. And this is the oxygen that we use for our survival. See how beautiful these things are inside the cell and how they are arranged inside the cell. This is only possible with the help of structural biology. So if there is any problem inside the cell, we can actually find out the actual source and we can correct it.
It was very, very amazing information about cell, the very wonderful tour about the cell.
Yes.
But I want to know whether similar thing you can tell about coronavirus or not.
Yeah. So, okay, let me take you to the another tour of the coronavirus where I can actually show how the coronavirus is coming and is actually going inside the cell and leading to that devastating effect.
So we all know about coronavirus. So this coronavirus, it originated in the Wuhan from China. And why we call it is coronavirus? Because this virus has a surface protein and by which it looks like as crown. So these virus particles are present in the water droplet when we sneeze out. And if anyone comes in contact with this water droplet, gets infected with it. So once you are infected, if you go and talk to anybody or touch anybody, what will happen? So these virus will go to their hands, and these people, if they go and touch that hand to their mouth, they get infected with that. So another thing is these virus, they can survive for a long time on various surface. Like if you go and touch some place, a virus will stay for some time. And if somebody again touches that place, what will happen? It will go and infect them. this virus is so infectious, so that if you come into in any environment where this virus is there, you will get infected with it. So now you might be wondering what this virus is made up of. So this virus, as I already told, this virus has a proteins on its surface which looks like as a crown, and it is those proteins which actually provide specificity to this virus. So if we don't have a receptor for these proteins, we will not get infected with them. So these proteins, if we go further closely, they are present on the outer membrane and they are present in large amount on the surface. So if you want to see what is there inside this virus, so this is an RNA virus. This RNA virus is actually having RNA as a genetic material, and it has a lot of nucleocapsid proteins which actually protects RNA from that. And these nucleocapsid proteins are structural proteins that forms complex with genomic RNA and interact with the viral membrane protein during viral assembly, and plays a critical role in enhancing the efficiency of virus transcription and the assembly. This protein also goes and binds to the ribosome which produced protein inside the cell, and hence by binding to them, it inhibits the protein production inside the cell. So as I told, there are different kind of protein on the surface. One of them is a spike protein. One is a membrane protein, M protein. This is a spike protein, and spike proteins is where the three proteins are actually trimerized in the form of spike trimer, and this provides specificity and the infectivity to the This is a spike protein, and spike proteins is where the three proteins are actually trimerized in the form of spike trimer, and this provides specificity and the infectivity to the virus. So this coronavirus actually uses its spike protein as a key to go inside the host cell, and when it goes inside the host cell, this actually takes over the entire machinery of the host cell. So when an infected person sneezes, there are a lot of coronaviruses which are present in the droplet. So they will go to a person which is present nearby, and that virus goes to the lungs of the recipient person. And these viruses, as I told you, that spike protein act as a key molecule to go inside the cell. So when they reach to the surface of the cell, what happens? They go and find their respective receptors. These receptors are known as ACE2 receptors. And once they bind to these ACE2 receptors, what happens? Specific proteases of the host cell comes and cleaves some of the part into the protein molecule. And after this, it leads to the internalization of the virus into the host cells. Once the virus is inside the host cell, so generally any virus, what will happen? It will go to the nucleus and it will release its genetic material there. When scientists were looking into the coronavirus, what they found? So these coronavirus, they remain into vesicles and they actually replicate into that vesicles. And into those vesicles, there are small pores from where they release their genetic material, as you can see over here. So once these pores are formed inside the membrane, so whatever proteins need to be made for the virus, it releases its genetic material out into the cytosol with the help of those pores which are formed during this process. And these genetic material will go outside into the cytosol and they will start looking for the ribosomes, which are basically the cellular machinery for making the proteins. They will hijack them and start making their own protein. After that, what it does, it packages all the proteins into a small package and will add its own genetic material into that, and new viruses are formed. And these formed viruses, they will start popping out of the cell and hence leading to the death of the host cell. And these virus particles, like thousands of the virus particles which are released from that infected cell, they will come out and hence infect the other cell. Now, you will ask how this coronavirus actually develop pneumonia-like symptoms. So, we have lungs in our body where this infection is actually taking place. In our respiratory system, we have trachea, we have bronchi, and there are further smaller tubes known as bronchioles where the actual exchange of gases take place. In this bronchiole, this alveoli, which has small blood vessels, these alveoli, they contract and expand alongside our lungs, and which actually help in exchange of gases with the blood vessels. Like you can see over here, whatever oxygen is coming will be put into the blood capillaries, and whatever carbon dioxide is produced in our body is released back into those alveoli. And while this is expanding, contracting, these gases are being released. So inside our lungs, these are not the only cells. There are immune cells are also there, known as macrophages. What they do, if there is any infection, they will start eating those infected cells. So in the case of coronavirus, whatever cells are infected, they are damaged, and these damaged cells, they will accumulate. Our immune cell will start attacking those cells which are infected, and due to that, lot of inflammation take place, and this inflammation lead to the accumulation of lot of fluid into that, and due to this fluid accumulation, we feel pneumonia like symptom into our body, and due to these pneumonia, we feel different symptoms like difficulty in breathing, chest pain, coughing, fever and chills, confusion, headache. So people who are having good immune systems, they will produce antibodies which actually go and bind to the receptors which is binding to our cells, and they will block the binding of these coronavirus to our cell. And these antibodies, they have so tighter affinity, they won't release these molecules and they will remain attached to them. And after these antibodies are there, now our immune cell know that this is a pathogen. So they will start acting over these molecules faster. As we know that there is protease which is required from the host to help in the infection of coronavirus. So when these antibodies are bound to these proteins, surface proteins, they will not allow these protease to act on this. And now, due to this, these virus further cannot go inside our cell, and hence our immune system fights with them, leading to no infection. And this is how our immune system helps in keeping us healthy. Now, scientists are actually trying to use the same mechanism to fight with this virus. So what they are trying to do, they are expressing these proteins and purifying them and giving those proteins to different organisms so that we can produce good antibody out of it. And those antibodies can be used as a vaccine to treat this coronavirus. Once we know these are the antibodies which can be used for it, so we can use that as a vaccine and we can prevent the coronavirus infection. These antibodies are Y in shape, and these are very specific for their target molecule. These antibodies are also made up of proteins only, and we can target specifically different part of this virus And once these antibodies are attached, our immune system can work further faster, hence leading to a good immune response, which will make us ultimately healthy and we will be protected from such viruses. Scientists are also trying to find out different chemicals which can be used as a drug molecule to treat the patients which are already infected with the virus. So these are the chemicals which go and bind at different place into different protein of the coronavirus. Hence, they can go and block their respective function. So in this video, you can see different chemicals are being discovered by the scientists which are under trial and can be used as a drug molecule for the corona patients. And there are other methods which are also being employed, like there are earlier known drugs which are known to inhibit the RNA viruses. Here we can see this is the protein known as RNA polymerase, which generates the RNA molecule of the coronavirus. So the drug known as remdesivir, it actually goes into its active site and stop duplication of the genome. Apart from this, scientists are also working how we can produce these molecules in very large amount, as a large population of our world is infected with this virus. So we will be in the need of good amount of these vaccines. And a faster immunization of people with these vaccines will help in saving the earth.
Hey, till now we have seen what are the things which are happening inside the cell. Now we are going to see what we are doing in CCMB.
Rice is one of the important crops for over half of our population, which provides 1/5 of the all calories consumed. In Asia, more than 250 million farmers cultivate rice. However, a small dip in the harvest can have catastrophic consequences like poverty, low nourishment, and sometimes even social unrest. One of the leading causes of rice crop loss is a disease called bacterial leaf blight of rice, which is caused by a gram-negative bacteria, Xanthomonas oryzae pathover oryzae. The typical symptoms of the leaf start from the tip of the leaf and the leaf dries off as the bacteria progress down the xylem vessel. If we look at the infected leaf using an electron microscope, we can see the bacterial growth. Now let us look at the events which take place during the infection. When the bacteria infect rice plant cell, the first barrier which it needs to cross in order to gain access to the nutrients is the plant cell wall. Plant cell wall is a complex structure which is made up of cellulose, hemicellulose, pectin, and lignin. So the bacteria secretes a battery of hydrolyzing enzymes to degrade this rigid barrier. These enzymes are important virulence factor of the bacteria. However, the byproduct of the cell wall degradation are recognized by the plant cell, which induce a defense response against the invading pathogen. Yes, plants also have strong immune system like us, which helps them in fighting against various bacteria, virus, fungi, and insects. Because of this strong defense system, we have beautiful plants around us. But sometimes this defense response is not enough. Like in this case, Xanthomonas secretes additional proteins which go and shut down this immune response and lead to successful establishment of the disease. By now, we have understood that XO is a very powerful and dangerous pathogen. It secretes these proteins which help it cause such severe disease. But if we can understand how these proteins function, what are the features which are absolutely essential for their functionality, then we can change those features and inactivate these proteins. One of the way of identifying function of a protein is to look at their structure. So that's what we have done here. We have solved structure of two cell wall degrading enzymes, lipase and cellobiosidase, And based on the structure, we have identified key features of these enzymes. And if we modify these features, then the protein becomes defective. Now let us see what happens during infection if bacteria has this defective form of enzyme instead of a functional one. So what we see is when pathogen has functional form of enzyme, it can cause severe damage to the rice leaf. But a pathogen with non-functional enzyme can no longer cause such severe damage. This is one of the examples where through structural biology, we have gained a better understanding of plant and pathogen interaction, which will eventually help us in combating the disease.
Yes.
We all know proteins are building blocks for any organism, and they help in performing simple functions like moving the limbs to complex ones like digestion and respiration. Proteins are made up of amino acids. Each amino acid has two parts, a common main chain and a varying side chain. The central atom of an amino acid is a carbon bonded to four different types of groups in all amino acids except glycine. These four types are a carboxylic group, an amino group, a hydrogen atom, and the variable side chain group. This allows two different types of arrangement of atoms of an amino acid, which are L-amino acid and D-amino acid. An easy way to find D in L-amino acid is the Korn rule. One assumption: the main chain hydrogen atom is in front of the central chiral carbon. If one reaches from carboxylic group to amino group through the side chain, R, in a clockwise direction, then it's L-amino acid and vice versa. Interestingly, all proteins have L-amino acids. D-amino acids perform functions like neurotransmitters, etc. In fact, our brain cells are highly enriched in D-amino acids and are necessary for transmitting signals from one nerve cell to another. Surprisingly, D-amino acids are absent in proteins, but CCMB work with such enzyme, which is known as D-aminoacyl-tRNA deacylase or DTD. We have solved the structure of DTD that shows and explains that DTD works on L-chiral rejection mechanism. The pocket is designed in such a way that allows chiral selectivity to select only D-amino acylated and loosely the glycylated tRNAs. The catalytic pocket made up of GLY cis pro motif cleaves the ester bond between amino acid and tRNA to avoid presence of D-amino acids in proteins. The DTD function is present in all life forms from bacteria to humans. Therefore, we are now probing the evolutionary and mechanistic role of DTD and DTD-like proteins to understand the proofreading process of protein synthesis.
Tuberculosis or TB is one of the deadliest diseases taking millions of lives around the world. The disease is caused by a tiny bacteria called Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Let's see how this bacterium gets inside the human body and infects us. The bacteria spread from an already infected individual and travel through air droplets to a healthy individual. Once the healthy person inhales the bacteria containing droplets, it gets into the lungs. There, these bacteria sit and start dividing. But remember, we also have our immune system. They are the tiny soldiers inside our body that fights constantly with these deadly bacteria and viruses. One of them is macrophage. Normally, they detect these bacteria and just eat them. Interestingly, you know, this tiny bacteria is very smart. They have lots of weapons and tactics to survive inside human body. In this case, they actually fool the macrophages. Macrophages eat the bacteria, but they can't digest them. So, these bacteria make their home inside macrophages and grow happily. Then our immune system fails to detect those bacteria. Over the time, they divide and make lots of colonies. These colonies are called granules, present inside the lungs. Once these granules are overloaded, they burst out from these and spread to other parts of the body.
So this is so horrific, isn't it? And that is why we need to kill these bacteria to get rid of them. But how do we kill them? we need to observe them very closely. We need to know, what do they do in their daily life? What do they do when they are inside the human body? How do they escape from our tiny soldiers of the immune system? For example, if we know exactly how a machine works, we can fix it when it's broken. Similarly, these bacteria also have tiny protein machines which help them to work and live happily inside human body. If we can see these proteins, we can plan to stop these protein machines. And thus, we can stop the deadly bacteria from working or growing inside our body. Yay! So now we know how to kill these nasty bacteria. These strategies are used by scientists across the world to make medicines or drugs for different diseases. Let's see more closely what can we do about it. After many years of research, scientists have understood that these mycobacteria have very thick cell wall around their cell body. This is like a bulletproof jacket for them. This is one of the reasons they are very hard to kill by our body's soldiers. The bacteria have a set of proteins inside them, which work like a factory to make the raw materials for their bulletproof jackets. You can compare these proteins' function to conveyor belt in a car factory, where all the parts of the car are made and assembled automatically. These proteins also work in the similar fashion. Isn't it so cool? Now think, if we can stop these protein machines, we'll be able to stop the production of their bulletproof jackets and they can be killed easily. We have solved the structure of such a protein which helps mycobacteria to make raw materials for their bulletproof jackets. Let's see how they look, and we will also try to understand how they work. So this protein is an enzyme. These are the different functional parts of the protein which we have colored differently. Oh, there is something at the center of the protein. Let's see what's that. This is called a ligand. This can be a substrate. In this case, this is a fatty acid bind to adenylate moiety. These are the different atoms which ligand is made up of. This is the sphere representation of the ligand. Here comes the stick representation. You can see the adenine ring, the ribose ring, and the phosphate. And here is the long fatty acid chain. Let's have a look on the secondary structure arrangement. If you have attended the introduction part, you might be aware of alpha helices, beta sheets, loops, etc., which you can clearly recognize here. This is called the active site of the protein, where the ligand is having its crucial interactions with the amino acid of protein. You can see aspartate interacting with the oxygen of ribose ring, the lysine residue interacting with another oxygen in red. So now, since we know where exactly the ligand binds to the protein and the crucial interactions involved for its function, we can easily design a molecule or drug which can bind to the active site of the protein, thus disabling the binding of proper ligand required for the protein to function. Another strategy invented by these bacteria is to make small tiny molecules with the help of these proteins. These tiny molecules are like toolbox which help them scavenging food and fight with the immune system inside our body. Similarly, we can also try to stop those proteins which make the toolbox materials. Nice idea. Let's do this together. This is one such protein called PKS, that is polyketide synthase. It has two identical parts which form a dimer. fatty acid is the raw material used by this protein. These are the two fatty acid binding sites in the two monomers colored differently. Now you can clearly see the yellow colored long carbon chain with carboxyl group at the end in red color. You can also see the secondary structures which line the fatty acid pocket. We will now see how does a protein look in its surface view. Now we will zoom in and will visit the fatty acid tunnel. Let's go inside the tunnel. We can see how long carbon chain of fatty acid in yellow is packed in the binding pocket of protein. This kind of protein factories are used by many bacteria to synthesize antibiotics and several other metabolites. And that is why these are very important for bacteria to survive. So, if we can block its functioning, the bacteria can be easily killed. So, this is the strategy used by scientists across the world to target a protein and design different drugs for many different diseases. These are some of the examples of drugs designed for tuberculosis by scientists after several years of research.
So there are other areas also where we are currently working in the lab. So now I'm going to take you through one of the important databases which is required for the structural biologist. And you can also go at your home and you can see through this. So this website is www.rcsb.org. So this website hosts whatever protein structures available till now on this. And you can see the total number of structures which are available till now. And this is how the homepage of this website looks like. There will be a description of the structural biology, and in one corner there will be a molecule named as molecule of the month. So there scientists handpick one of the molecule and explain about it so that even a common person can understand. Apart from all this, there will be the information available about the latest structures which are being currently published in the database, and these are the structures which are released recently. There are different options, like if you want to search into the database, there is a description how you can search for it. Like we can search for any protein of your interest, like insulin. We know that insulin has a role in diabetes. So if you search insulin over there, you can find out now the insulin will be in the search results. You can select one of them, and this will lead to the opening of the page where all the structures related to insulins are available. There will be structures for insulin, there will be structures for insulin receptor, and these are the protein sequences and the protein structures which are available from the different organisms. If you want to visualize any of the protein at your desktop screen, you can go to the visualize option and you can see any protein of your interest. Like here we are going to see with the help of one of the protein. So in this, there is online structural visualization tool is available, and there are a lot of options which are being given. If you want to hide anything, you can hide. You want to show something, you can show. And all those informations are available over there. So there are different options which are available with this online visualization tool. And you can play with it like you play video game at your home. Now, if you want to change the visualization parameters of this molecule, we can change over here. If you want to change the color of the molecule, you can change from this. background can also be adjusted with the help of these tools, and we can make a good picture out of it. So once we are done with this, we can find the best picture we want from this molecule. And with the help of all these options, we can capture an image required for our purposes. This can be saved onto your desktop. There are different options, like if you want to save an image with a background, without a background, like a transparent image. If you want to analyze the molecule in detail, you can go to the zoom option. There you can see in the molecular detail of this protein. You can click any of the amino acid. There you will see all the molecular network that particular amino acid is making. Hence, through this, we can go for a good structural analysis. And there are different options are over there on the top of this bar where we can do whatever we want to do. So this is how this database actually helps in visualization of the structure and analysis. So let us go back to the original homepage where we have seen there is this molecule that is known as molecule of the month. So we'll go and see in detail what is that particular option over there. So this can also be found in the tab Learn. If you go and click on this molecule of the month, it will go and open up the page for all the molecule of the months which are being written so far. So if we want to know about the latest molecule, we can go and click into the latest issue or the current issue. In that, we can find out the molecule of the month for this month is SARS-CoV-2 RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, and all the authentic information is available at this page. And this database also provides different learning techniques. Like if you want to learn about this paper models of the molecule, you can go and select your favorite molecule. Like if you want to go and learn about DNA molecule, so we can go and select that. If it will open a home page where all the information how to make a paper model is given. There is an option to go and download the PDF where all the information is available for how to make this DNA molecule. And as you can quickly see, all the information is there in this. So we can print this page, and as per the instruction, if you cut it and fold it, ultimately you will have a DNA molecule in your hand. There are other important resources like flyer, posters. So we have heard about antibiotics. Do you know how these antibiotics works? You can find all the information where all these antibiotics go and bind into the bacteria and their mechanism, how they kill that bacteria. It is available in the flyer and poster region of this. It also hosts a resource in the form of video where you can quickly learn about the proteins, how they are arranged, and different enzymes into action. And there are interactive animations are also available where you can go and click one of them and you can have a feel how these different molecules look like and how they are arranged. There is one more option, that is coloring book, which is for school kids. So there you will find the sketchbooks where you can fill the colors, and this is available for school children, and we can download all this for free. So like this, there are other different resources which are available at this database. This database also publishes quarterly its magazine where we can find out different learning resources into it.
Hey again. Now we got some basic idea about proteins, how these proteins look like, how cells function, and techniques used to solve protein structure. Now let's have fun. It's time for the quiz. Let's refresh our brains with some questions. I hope you all are ready. Then log into menti.com and give your email ID as your username and give 19117591. I repeat, 19117591 as your passcode.
Kaushik, can you please write it in the chat box also?
I repeat, give your email ID as your username and use the passcode 9117591.
Open your browser. He's sharing the screen.
So the link and the passcode is available on the screen.
Please write the link and the password on the chat boxes, both on YouTube and MS Teams.
Thank you. Thank you.
So congratulations, D. Mohan Chaitanya Reddy. So you will be contacted through your email, and your letter of appreciation will come to you. So then now we are going towards interactive session. So people who wants to ask question through MS Teams can raise your hand, and after you get the confirmation that you can unmute yourself, you can unmute yourself and ask your question. So before going into it, we are going to address first question from YouTube, which is asked by Naseema. Why do we have so many amino acids? Though it was already answered in YouTube, for the other people it can be answered again.
Hello. Okay. We have 20 different amino acids, which have different side chains, and they are responsible for different sequence variations. The 20 different amino acids can be attached in different combinations, and due to which we get a huge sequence diversity. And the biggest question is, why did nature stop at 20 different amino acids? And the same is true for nucleotides as well. When you come to DNA, it's why only 4 nucleotides? When you come to RNA, why only 4 nucleotides? So these questions are still remains unexplored, but what we can give based on the present understanding is 20 different amino acids gives enough variation already to the genetic code. Next question.
So the second question from YouTube is, does the coronavirus genome have non-necessary DNA? Like, our genome sometimes has DNA of pathogens that had infected our ancestors in the past. I heard that bacteriophages have such residual DNA. This question was asked by Siddharth.
A good question. First of all, coronavirus genome is made up of RNA, but not DNA. And it's not a big compared to human genome and all. It's a very, very small genome in size, around 25 kb. If you look at the coding regions, most of the genome codes for proteins and essential things. So there is hardly any non-essential part of the genome which can be coding for non-coding RNA or something. So I hope I have answered your question. And yes, in bacteriophages, it's very well pretty known that they carry bacterial DNA and all. As of now, with respect to the corona genome, we do not see something of such that. However, there is lots of biology still to be explored into it. Do we have more questions?
So another question from YouTube, which was asked by Yashwant Rao. So what are the defenses a plant cell has against bacteria other than its cell wall? Is the defense response similar to that of animals?
This question will be answered by Raj Kanwa. She works on plant immune system and how bacteria evades the plant immune system.
So in plant cell also, like animal cells, there is something called programmed cell death, in which the cells which are infected by pathogen, they undergo cell death so as to stop the spread of the infection. Other than that, in plant cell, there is something called generation of reactive oxygen species that also inhibit growth of the bacteria. And as I said in the comment section also, other than this, there is callose deposition in the cell wall that also inhibits the spread of the infection.
So the next question from YouTube, asked by Sharda Gupta. So are there any software to make illustrative videos and diagrams of cell biology?
There is something called Adobe Illustrator, which can be used for this.
Is there any other questions from the audience side? In MS Teams, if you are in MS Teams, you can raise your hands and you can unmute yourself and ask your question. Pawan ji, you can unmute yourself and you can ask your question. Hello, Pawan ji, you can unmute yourself and you can ask your question.
Hello, am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes, you are audible.
Yeah, are there any in vivo techniques which are currently being used or being developed which are as good as X-ray crystallography or NMR crystallography in terms of the resolution and the way the quality it gives the structure anything?
So like what that. I understand from your question is you're asking, are there in vivo techniques where we can actually study the structures of proteins inside the cell? So yeah. The answer is yes. There are a technique called a cryo-EM. A variation to it is a tomography. Tomography is where in vivo you look at how macromolecules are arranged and you try to solve the structures by using live cells. And if you're really keen on knowing more about it, there's a guy called Professor Grant Jensen from Caltech. Have a look at that. He has many, many videos where he has clearly shown how macromolecules operate at the cellular level in vivo.
Okay.
Is there any other questions from the audience side? Mohan Chaitanya, you can unmute yourself and ask your question.
Good morning, sir. How did coronavirus have surface proteins that are complementary to the receptors of our blood? Because it hasn't been interacted with humans before getting infected to us?
That's a pretty good question. If I understand your question, I want to repeat it for the audience, that what he's asking, how the coronavirus proteins are able to bind the ACE receptor of humans, which it has haven't seen before till today. Point one, this coronavirus is a variant of already existing coronaviruses. It is not entirely new. It means the genome is not, you cannot say that it is not at all identical to any other genome till today. So it is all coming, it's a variation which has deviated good enough from the already existing coronavirus. That gives more or less the answer. And with respect to ACE receptors, humans are not the only one which are having the ACE receptors.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So another question from YouTube, which is asked by Sipra. So how do you determine the function of a newly isolated protein?
Okay, that's a pretty good question. Looking at the protein sequences, we have already explored good number of proteins where if you have identity between, say, looking at the sequence, you can guess what is it, which protein is it close to earlier known proteins. And then you look at what is the probable substrate possible for it. So there are different techniques to find out this. One is you can also find out in vivo, if you delete this particular protein, which of the analogs or metabolites going up and going down. So based on this, we can do this. So basically, it's mostly related with homology, how it resembles to other proteins.
So the next question from YouTube is asked by Siddhant. Have heard that some structures known as chaperones enable folding of proteins. How are chaperones themselves formed?
That's a pretty good question. This is a question like chicken and egg question, which is asked in many, many cases. And here we are not an exception too. But one of the answer I can give you, not all proteins require chaperones. Most of the proteins fold on by themselves. But in special cases where there is problem in the way the protein is folding and all, there'll be misfolding and they'll be stuck in something called local minimas, which is very common when folding. So that is the time when chaperones get into and help the proteins to fold. So as I said, not all proteins require chaperones to fold.
So the next question from the YouTube is by Shahiti, how the virus get multiplied inside the host body?
Okay, so viruses get multiplied in the host body, but first they enter the cell and then they hijack the entire translation machinery of the cell and also the transcription machinery. The RNA particles are continuously synthesized. Since the entire host, proteome and the cellular functioning is hijacked by the viruses, it utilizes all the resources of the host cell and then starts generating new variant particles.
Pavanji, you can unmute yourself and ask your question. Pavanji, you can unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yes, sir. I already did. Thank you. I asked my question in the beginning.
Yeah. Thank you, Pavanji. So another question from the YouTube. Can we synthesize a particular protein outside from a cell? By Durgesh.
Answer is yes. Protein synthesis is done. Say if a human protein is being, you want to clone and express a human protein. You don't need a human to express and clone a express a protein which of human origin. What we do is simply there's molecular DNA technologies where we take the sequence which codes for this protein because the human genome is already available. Take that particular sequence, clone it into a vector, in which can be expressed in a simple E. coli or bacterial cell, and you can express those proteins. So there are other called in vitro translation systems as well, where you can synthesize a protein. So they have isolated ribosome, everything, the cellular extracts. You need to provide an RNA inside a tube, and you can synthesize the proteins there as well.
Okay. So the next question is it true that men need more protein than women? I guess it is a more nutrition question than biology question?
The answer to this question is no. So it is depends on the physiology. So it depends on the age group, and there are many other considerations when you do get into such kind of discussions. And I know it is more of a contextual question rather than which will not have a 0-1 answer for these kind of questions.
So we are in our last question of this session. So the last question is, things enter the cell using osmosis. How do the proteins accurately move around inside the cell? This question was asked by Yashwant.
Can you please repeat the question?
Yes.
So things enter the cell using osmosis. How do the proteins accurately move around inside the cell?
Okay. So if I understand your question, molecules or particles enter the cell through osmosis. And so point one here, I have to clarify that every whatever is around the cell cannot enter the cell. There is a selective permeability inside the cell, as well as there are many, many receptors on the cell and ion channels, which allow channels, aquaporins and all, which allow only selective molecules to cross the barrier. So therefore, it's not just an osmosis which always operates there. And then coming to the next question, how proteins keep moving inside the cell? So depending on the requirement, so generally they are floating inside the cytoplasm, but there is a ER network, there is a cytoskeleton on which the vesicles and all the cargos are keep moving on. So it's just like railway tracks which are laid inside the cell on which those are the dynein and tubulins and all, on which the tubulin is laid, on which the motors keep pushing the cargos to their destinations. This is very well explored, and it was earlier shown in our earlier videos as well.
So that's it for the day. All the unanswered questions in the YouTube session will be answered through the comments. So we are at the end of our session. So from this session, we came to know what is structural biology, how things work inside the cell, virtually. So we are stopping here. Our next session of this day is from Dr. Swasti Rai Chaudhary's lab, and the session's topic is from caterpillar to butterfly. So followed by that, we are having our panel discussion, Wildlife Matter, which is exclusively for conservation biology, and we are looking forward for that. Thank you.
Thank you.
And I request all the participants to fill the feedback form, which is there in the MS chat link or MS chat link, and which is also there in the YouTube chat box. Thank you.